Thank you very much. Good morning. So this is my financial disclosures. Okay. So aspirin for everyone, aspirin for no one, gut feelings or an evidence-based medicine. I think I can show you that there is a lot of evidence. In this slide, you can see that aspirin reduces the risk of recurrent colorectal adenoma. It is true in North America, it is true in Europe, and even in Japan. Aspirin, even at low dose, can reduce adenoma recurrence. This is 26 case control studies. We can see that the odds ratio is 0.67 in more than 26,000 patients. It can reduce the incidence of colorectal cancer. This is cohort studies, 19 studies, almost 19,000, 25% reduction. And even randomized control trial, this is a pool data from the British doctors and the UK TIA trials, and you can clearly see when you compare the aspirin, non-aspirin and aspirin, and this is a risk for colorectal cancer, there was a 26% reduction in the incidence. It was in the risk, it was 37% reductions if the drug was used, aspirin was used for 5 years, but it is important to understand that the effect was seen after a decade. So we have to wait, we have to be patient. And even if you have a patient with cancer, if you then put him on aspirin, then it reduces the risk of metastasis. And in high-risk patients, we just heard about HNPCC. This is a result of the CAP2, which was led by John Byrne from Newcastle. When we give aspirin, 600 milligrams, for 1 to 4 years to patients with HNPCC, with the follow-up for more than 4 years, then a reduction of 38% was seen. CAP3 is ongoing, and it's going to give us the answer, do we need this high dose of aspirin of 600 milligrams? Because in that study, we are going to compare 600, 300, and 100 milligrams. This slide was given me by Andrew Cho. He's leading of analyzing the data from the Nurse Health study in the app, more than 120,000 women, and the health professional follow-up study with 51,000 participants. They score for many factors, including the use of aspirin. And this is what they found, that aspirin reduced colon cancer specific survival, but maybe what is more important, I'm going to allude to it later on in my talk, about overall survival, because this is really what we care. And we can see that specific mortality was reduced by 29% and overall mortality by 21%. Obviously, very impressive data. But it's not only colon cancer. As we can see it here, also the risk for esophageal cancer, for lung cancer, and all solid cancer was reduced in this meta-analysis looking for almost 13,000 participants. In this meta-analysis, we can see that aspirin reduces the risk of 10 out of 11 cases of cancers, only kidney. We do not have any good explanations why in kidney the numbers was, the odds ratio was increased, but the rest, 10 tumors, aspirin was effective. So we can show you some more data. In this slide, we can see that aspirin reduced risks of all cancer death in 8 cardiovascular randomized control trials. We can see it here again. Everything that is on the left is good, and this is in secondary prevention, but even in primary prevention, as we can see it here, aspirin reduced cancer mortality. At the same time, there was some significant bleeding. A case of bleeding for every 73 persons. So it is some of concerns. And we do know that aspirin do have some side effects. Some nuisance symptoms, heartburn, nausea, vomiting, dyspepsia, mucosal lesion, and even serious GI complications. Ulcers, perforated ulcer, bleeding, hepatic toxicity, and obstruction. And you can see it here that this, we can see it here that the dose of aspirin and risk of GI bleeding, so it is dose-dependent fashions. You have to take 2 to 5 tablets per week in order to see this bleeding, which quite high dose of this. So aspirin and GI bleeding, it is 2 to 3 per 1,000 subjects per year, maybe a catastrophe, a crisis, but the risk diminishes with time. Aspirin does not increase fatal bleeding, and gastroprotective drugs are highly effective but are underused. And I'm a gastroenterologist, and it's really very, very rare to see that aspirin or even NSAID cause major bleeding nowadays. I think this is much more of in the past. Now when we are eradicating Helicobacter pylori, we are using more of the proton pump inhibitors, this catastrophe is less of effective. But if I may quote Bob Sandler, and he said aspirin for no one, it was almost 20 years ago. Although aspirin may prevent the disease, it may increase the risk of hemorrhagic stroke or cause other adverse events. After a decade, the United States Preventive Service Task recommends against routine use of aspirin or NSAIDs to prevent colorectal cancer in average risk individuals. Harms outweigh the benefit for the primary prevention of colorectal cancer. And only 2 years ago, in a paper that we published, and even me was there on this consortium, we said that there is a lack of consensus about the balance of risk and benefit associated with long-term use of aspirin. Maybe I can show you that we can change this paradigm. And I agree with this most. Definitely one should take no risk, but maybe we are not taking any risk. There is some ongoing aspirin clinical trials with cancer or mortality at the endpoint. There is actually many, many of them, but we have to be a little patient until we can know the results somewhere in 2017, 18. It will take some time, but there is quite many of them, as you can see it here. So there is many studies that are going to tell us, and they are what we should really look for, morbidity and mortality. But I think that nobody in the previous chapters consensus really tried to see what we know and we are talking about now, the precision medicine. And I think that if we do personalized aspirin therapy, we can increase the efficacy and decrease the toxicity. So just like take patients with high risk for colorectal cancer, familial polyposis, HNPCC, lifetime risk of 80 to 100%, no doubt that this patient should be put on aspirin or NSAIDs. Even patients with moderate risk, this with personal or family history of colon cancer, 10 to 20% risk of colorectal cancer, we should carefully think to put them, trying to prevent them with any type of medications. What about the approach in the general population? 30 to 50% are going to have adenoma, 1.2 million new cases, lifetime risk 5 to 6%. Definitely we should advocate for lifestyle modification, diet, exercising, tobacco avoidance, limitations of alcohol, obviously screening. Should we prescribe aspirin? Obviously not for everyone. But maybe we are able to try to target aspirin therapy to those persons with risky phenotypes, smokers, sedentarians, obese, alcohol, those who are consuming red meat, or even specific genetic profile. Driver published in 1997 risk score for colorectal cancer in men. It was based on simple things like age, smoking, body mass index, alcohol use. And those at higher risk had 15 odds ratio of having colorectal cancer as compared to those with slowest risks. We were trying to modify this risk by adding some genetics, some polymorphism in the APC genes, and actually we are able to even to improve this score, and definitely this is something that should be going to develop in the upcoming years, how we can choose the patients. So is aspirin is effective only if he takes it every day, as we can see it in this. If you take it less than once a day, it is not effective. Aspirin is effective after a decade of use. Again, we have to remember that we have to take it for the long run. And this is one of the problems. Side effects develop fast in the first 1 to 2 years. Benefit we can see after a decade. So I think to give aspirin its actions of omissions, we do give it, we will have to be willing to accept the short-run side effects, while waiting for the long-run efficacy. And this you can see in the Women Health Initiative, that post-trial long-term follow-up, only after a decade, the efficacy of aspirin was seen. It is also important, as we can see it in highlight in yellow, that aspirin decreases the long-term, especially of proximal colorectal cancer. This is a different issue, but maybe we should combine aspirin with colonoscopy. With colonoscopy, and I'm gastroenterologist, I can tell you that for the right side lesions, we are not that good as compared to the left side. So maybe we should combine, or maybe we should still wait that someone will raise a hat and do a comparison between screening colonoscopy and aspirin. I tried to offer it, but nobody was willing to invest in this kind of study. Let's see a little bit more about the genetic profile. And we know that aspirin is effective only in adenoma that express COX-2. In non-COX-2 expressors, aspirin is not effective. Aspirin is effective only in wild-type BRAF tumor. So if we have mutations in BRAF, aspirin is not going to work. We know it. Aspirin is effective only in cancers with PIK3 mutations. Only when you have the mutations in the wild type, the effect is significantly lower. Aspirin is effective in reduced adenoma recurrence only in those who produce prostaglandin. It makes sense. Aspirin inhibits COX-1 and COX-2, so it inhibits prostaglandin. So if there is no tumors that produce high levels of prostaglandin, aspirin is not going to work. Aspirin is effective only when we have increased plasma of serum TNF-alpha receptors. So I think if we are going to use personalized and we are going to analyze the genome, we are going to analyze the tumors or the adenoma, then we will be able to better pick up and select our patients to increase efficacy and decrease toxicity. But let's take a scenario. When a patient is coming to me and he asks me, I would like to live longer and better. It really doesn't care that I'm able to prevent colon cancer, but at the same time he's going to do from cerebral hemorrhage. Patients want to live longer and better. And currently there are 3 major killing diseases: cardiovascular, cancer, and Alzheimer. It's difficult to calculate the likelihood of somebody to develop ischemic heart disease or myocardial infarction in the upcoming decade. It's based on the Framingham study, Framingham score, simple things like age, gender, total cholesterol, HDL, smoking. It's easy to determine. And based on this, we are able to develop who is going to develop a ischemic heart disease, myocardial infarctions or not. And in this study, we can look for what I was alluding to, not looking for cardiologists looking for ischemic heart disease. We are gastroenterologists, oncologists looking for gastric cancer. What are we going to do if we are going to prescribe aspirin? So if the patients are age 50, 40, 55 to 60, then we can prevent 400 major coronary events. And when you're age 67 to 5, 1,200, altogether 1,600. There is some price to it, price of bleeding, all over 1,000. But as we say, this is bleeding, but it's not catastrophe. What about incidence of colorectal cancer? We can save about 1,000. So overall, if you calculate in this, In this study, in this mathematical model, we can see that efficacy is much more significant better than the toxicity. And this is another study show that aspirin effect on risk of bleed and MI in the first 3 years. This is exactly what we said in the first year, 3 years, but especially for aspirin, for bleeding, it's even in the first months, then we see the toxicity. While for the efficacy, we have to wait for a longer period of time. So this is what I call for personalized therapy. We should calculate the 10-year risk of ischemic heart disease, colorectal cancer, and Alzheimer. Though it's high risk for cardiovascular disease, more than 20% according to the Framingham study, no doubt they should be put on aspirin. Those with high risk for colorectal cancer, HNPCC, MYH, FAP, they should be put on aspirin or NSAIDs. Those with Alzheimer's disease, and now we can calculate those with strong family history, and there is 4 known mutations with 15% risk of Alzheimer's disease, most probably they should be put on aspirin, and there is some ongoing study showing that aspirin can be beneficial in this setting. On the other hand, those with low risk for cardiovascular disease, less than 10% likelihood of having myocardial infarction in the upcoming decade, they should not be put on aspirin. Those at low risk for colorectal cancer, no symptoms, no family history, negative colonoscopy, they should not be put on aspirin, or low risk for Alzheimer's disease. Usually, we are balancing those with moderate risk, what I call clear-cut borderline case. Those with moderate risk for ischemic heart disease. If they have low risk for colorectal cancer, low risk for Alzheimer's disease, I should discuss it with the patient, but most probably no aspirin is going to indicate it. Those with medium risk for ischemic heart disease, medium risk for colorectal cancer, medium risk for Alzheimer's disease, again, I would discuss it with the patients, but most probably aspirin should be given, providing that this is mostly in the proximal colon, expressing COX-2, and as we said, the other genetic markers that we have discussed. Those with low risk for colorectal cancer and medium risk for Alzheimer's disease, or medium risk for colorectal cancer and low risk for Alzheimer's disease, we have to discuss it with the patients. It's borderline. We should don't know should we give, although it definitely is going to be a personal decision of our patients. So if we have to summarize the risk balance for the aspirin use, I think the balance tilts into benefit. The benefit is significantly higher than the risk, and especially we can decrease the risk of the side effects of aspirin. This was just published by Kuzik, paper in Alice of Oncology, when he was analyzing the net aspirin benefit in a woman, and we can see that the net benefit was seen, no doubt. And maybe in men it's even higher. It's again risk for cancer, and if you use aspirin, it goes down, and the risk of cardiovascular disease goes down, and there is a total decrease. There is some increase in bleeding, but there we can see the net benefit. So definitely there is a place for aspirin. We just published a paper, actually 2 years' time flies, but we just published a paper about the impact of genetic polymorphism on adenoma recurrence and toxicity in the Celecoxib trial, the PRISAP trial that I, with Bernard Levine, had the honor to lead. And it was amazing that based on single SNP, single nucleotide polymorphism, we're able to predict efficacy, GI toxicity, and cardiovascular toxicity. You're invited to read the paper. There was just another paper about the associations of aspirin and NSAID use with the risk of colorectal cancer according to some genetic variants. I think in the future, and we are just now conducting another trial with the European Union, with the Horizon 2020, called TRASCAN, where we are trying to do exactly the same things about the aspirin trials, and we are trying to evaluate efficacy and toxicity. So, ladies and gentlemen, there is strong evidence exists for a cancer-preventing effect of low-dose aspirin. But remember, we have to take it every day and to take it at least for a decade. Benefits outweigh the risk. All benefits and risk into, we should take all benefits and risk into account to provide the optimum guidance. In particular, benefits in cancer, vascular, and Alzheimer's disease. Genomic and neoplastic molecular signatures should be definitely monitored, and it can predict efficacy and toxicity. And I agree with this gentleman that an aspirin a day will help prevent the heart attack if you have it for lunch instead of a cheeseburger. Thank you very much for your attention.